everyone. Welcome to another week of This Week in Jewish History. Something really interesting for you this week, the life and work of the amazing Chofetz Chaim. This week, Jews around the world will commemorate the yahrzeit of Rabbi Israel Meir Kagan, known more popularly by the name of one of his greatest works, the Chofetz Chaim. He passed away on the 24th day of the month of Elul in the Hebrew calendar, which corresponds to the year 1936. Let's just take a minute to look at his life and work. So this is the iconic image of the Chofetz Chaim, by which he is recognized throughout the Jewish world. In reality, most scholars believe this is not a fair likeness of him, but rather of some other resident of the town of Radin in Lithuania, where he made his claim to fame. Here is a photograph which is authentic. It shows you a little bit better what the Chofetz Chaim looked like. We have, however, precious few actual likenesses of him that survived the 20th century. His most famous work, the one by which he received his title, Chofetz Chaim, is a book on the laws of speech, a rather amazing work of spiritual genius, a revolutionary work, in fact, which culled together the vast number of discussions in the Talmud, the Midrash, the Zohar, and elsewhere on this subject of forbidden speech, specifically what we would call in English, but in Hebrew it's really a much more sophisticated term. This is the title page of that first edition, and apparently it was published anonymously, and in fact in the Hebrew text shown here, his name does not appear, but something I've always wondered about, in the Russian text at the very bottom, you can see his name is written quite clearly, E.M. Kagan, means that anyone who could read Russian would know right away that, in fact, he was the author. But nevertheless, there are many legends that circulate that he intended it to remain anonymous. Perhaps one of the viewers will comment on this strange anomaly that the first edition actually has his name on it, despite the belief that he wrote this anonymously. But at any rate, it immediately became an overnight sensation among the Torah observant community of Eastern Europe because of his very strong, clear and authoritative voice when it came to the laws of forbidden speech. Specifically, he outlined just how forbidden it is, this subject known as Lashon Hara, which actually covers, unlike in American law, it covers true speech. That is, spreading lies about a person is a much more serious crime called Motzi Shemra, but in Jewish law, the concept of Lashon Hara, of gossip, refers exclusively to things which are in fact true and verifiable. Nevertheless, they are completely forbidden. And in this masterful work, he exhorts Jews to be much more careful with how they relate negative information, and he outlines seven specific preconditions which must be met before a person relates negative information. I've arranged them here in a kind of a neat acronym that I'm kind of proud of, the word silence, which has these seven letters, and basically before one relates Lashon Hara, one must, following the letters there, S, search for alternatives to Lashon Hara, meaning find a way to change the topic or to achieve the objective without saying something negative about a person. I, which is actually the most important one, intend a positive practical result. In Hebrew, a toelet, meaning that there has to be some really good reason why you're saying these negative things. L, look for exonerating factors. Perhaps the information you're about to relate is in fact true, but there were special circumstances. E, exaggeration is forbidden. If you are going to be forced to reveal this negative information, it has to be exactly what you saw and what you know. Related to that, N, no hearsay is permitted. You have to be a direct witness yourself. C, very importantly, consequences should be proportionate. Even if all of the other preconditions are met, it may be that by relating this negative information, the cost to the person who is the subject of the discussion will be far greater than really is appropriate for the crime involved or the wrongdoing involved. And finally, E, engage the subject first, meaning before you say something negative about a person, you really should speak with that person first and give them the opportunity to come clean. Now, this is a very brief and very rough description of the majesty of these laws, and I strongly urge viewers to have a look at the work of the Chofetz Chaim, which has been translated into many languages. He was, however, known for many things besides this first great initial work. He was known throughout the Jewish world after he published his massive Mishnah Brura, here shown in the Hebrew English edition. In Hebrew, it came out in 6 volumes, which was a singularly authoritative discussion of one of the 4 sections of the Code of Jewish Law, and really eclipsed most of the other commentaries that had been written in the early 20th century. And it has become, without doubt, the premier authoritative modern commentary on the Code of Jewish Law. He was also quite active as a communal leader, taking a strong position on all kinds of things, such as women's education, activity in politics. He reached out to Jews in America with books like Nidchei Yisrael, and in general really took an activist position with regards his widely recognized scholarship that extended over the course of nearly a century. His legacy is profound and diverse. There is a major yeshiva in New York shown here that bears his name and carries on his legacy, and many, many other institutions and movements are profoundly affected by the laws of speech that he codified, and also by his major commentary on Jewish law, not to mention many of the other areas in which he was deeply active. I'd like to conclude with something that is related, but is a little bit more of a personal plug. My new book just came out, The Kabbalah of Forgiveness. It does deal with the laws of Lashon Hara in Chapter 7, and it's being offered right now as a free download for viewers of these videos. Please visit smashwords.com, put in that title and this coupon code, and you will get a free download for whatever ebook reader you use. It's also available, of course, in conventional formats through traditional retailers. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you have an amazing week.